academia tends to value prior venture and value creation. It's all about what have you published, what grants have you won in order to unlock that brass ring of tenure. Well, entrepreneurship's not about what have you done for me, it's about what are you gonna do for the business. I never heard talk of entrepreneurship or startups, even as an option and a path. I think it's been this really beautiful wave of change and evolution of what higher ed can be and how we can change the trajectory of somebody's life and their career in a class, in a meeting, in an opportunity. We're here to help be entrepreneurial alchemists and turn that into the potential for somebody to be a leader, a founder, you name it. Just gotta eat glass and make a meal out of it. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not gonna be fun getting those learnings, but that's how you grow as a founder.
Welcome to Forging the Future, where we dive into the minds of innovators and leaders shaping tomorrow. Today, I'm thrilled to have Kyle Judah with us. Kyle is the mastermind behind Rice University's Liu Idea Lab for Innovation and Entrepreneurship, also known as Lilie. With a background in fostering startup ecosystems, Kyle has a wealth of insights to share on how to launch world-changing startups. Welcome, Kyle.
Thanks so much, Chris. It's a real pleasure and privilege to be here with you today.
Yeah, I'm excited to have this conversation, and I'm glad you renamed it Lilie, because that's a mouthful.
It is, isn't it? And we love our acronyms in higher ed, right? Higher ed, military, and healthcare can't exist without the acronyms.
I used to work at an acronym company called IBM.
I've heard of them, yeah.
Yeah, and they had an actual book that was like, I don't know, 400 pages thick of acronyms.
Yep.
As you can imagine, their company name was an acronym, so yeah. So tell me a little bit about Lilie. You know, what was the background and how did it get started?
Yeah, so Lilie exists as kind of the epicenter for the Rice University campus community. So that's students, postdocs, researchers, staff and faculty, as well as alumni. And we're really a one-stop shop for anything that they might need to dip their toe into the pool of innovation and entrepreneurship, to ideate, to prototype, to accelerate their venture, ultimately, so that they can hit escape velocity and transition from the campus to the community and grow and thrive and be that next generation of pillar company for Houston, for Texas, and for the country.
So it's really open for students and faculty?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. I think the really nice, unique element about Rice is it's still a small enough campus community that you can kind of wrap your hands around it. And so that makes a lot more sense to have one kind of centralized place versus making it into this hunt and gather treasure hunt for founders or potential founders to have to try and kind of sort through the haystack to find the needle that they're looking for.
And how long has it been at Rice?
Yeah, it's existed for about 8 years now. And really the impetus and the catalyst for its creation was my boss, Professor Yael Hochberg, who's the tenured professor in entrepreneurship at Rice Business, and a Rice alum by the name of Frank Liu, who's created Love It Homes and Love It Industrial, the commercial real estate developers in town, really saw that Rice was doing this incredible job of promoting entrepreneurship for Houston and for the world through phenomenal external events like the Rice Business Plan Competition and a lot of others that kind of lit the beacon to bring startups and investors and corporate innovators to town and to the Rice campus. But in doing so, we kind of forgot to take care of our own garden because there wasn't really an entrepreneurship center dedicated for the whole campus. There was kind of dribs and drabs of it across the business school over the years, but there was really a need for a home for Rice entrepreneurs, and that's exactly what Lilie is.
Hmm. Okay, and then how did you end up there?
Great question. So I was lucky enough to get to know Yael when both of us were at MIT kind of earlier in my career, now about a decade ago. I had my company acquired and was catching my breath, so I thought at the time, and kind of learning about how universities like MIT, like Rice, really pulled together all the pieces of the ecosystem. Because universities are this kind of natural neutral territory, right? It's not a big Fortune 500 company. It's not a venture firm. It's not a small startup. It's not the government and civic bureaucracy sometimes, but it can kind of exist as that liminal space for all of those folks to come together. So I was there. She was there at the same time. We got to meet, know one another. We stayed in touch and worked on a lot of her research around entrepreneurial ecosystems over the years. And in the very calm, placid days of like April 2020, she reached out to me and she said, "Hey, we've got this opening down here. You will be blown away by the caliber of student, the degree of ambition, the groundbreaking research that's going on here. We just need somebody to come in and pour jet fuel on the fire." And I like throwing Molotov cocktails, so that worked out really well for me.
Okay. Do you think there's been a shift, really, I mean, in universities and how they think about training, like, students? Like,
yeah.
In the 80s when I went, the university were like, "Well, we're colleges, we're not trade schools.
Right.
You know, you come here and learn the humanities,
yeah,
and get a well-rounded education,
yeah,
and we're not so interested in whether you can find a job or not."
Yeah.
They really leaned into training for industry, and then also even the entrepreneurship side.
Very much so. I think, I was at school a little bit after your time, but even then, I went to UMass Amherst, state flagship university. I never heard talk of entrepreneurship or startups, even as an option and a path. I think it started kind of in the mid to late 2000s with a lot of, obviously, Stanford and Harvard and MIT, UChicago, Northwestern, you name it, kind of leading the charge of really pushing their chips in, making the investment from their endowments and from donors and others to really catalyze that kind of parallel model for what a university can be. And I think seeing the success that those universities have had has encouraged a lot of other university presidents and administrations to say, like, "Oh, this is a thing that can work for us." And rather than, you know, our tech transfer office looking like that scene in the Raiders of the Lost Ark where they're in the dusty warehouse, we should actually invest in translating this technology from the lab to people's living rooms so it can actually make an impact beyond just the point of publication alone. And then I think the groundswell of the student demand started even further galvanizing that kind of same wave of interest, wave of investment. I think we kind of have to give credit to the Social Network movie that kind of popularized it and made startups and tech mainstream. Maybe not cool yet, but mainstream.
We can hope.
we can always hold out hope.
Us nerds.
And we started seeing more and more students, MBAs, undergrads, PhDs coming in saying, "I want to explore this." And this container of the 4 years of my undergrad or 2 years of my MBA or blah, blah, blah years of my PhD, that's the right kind of low risk time for me to try something new, put myself in uncomfortable territory and build new muscle. And so I think it's been this really beautiful wave of change and evolution of what higher ed can be and how we can change the trajectory of somebody's life and their career in a class, in a meeting, in an opportunity for them.
Well, have universities gotten better now at it? I mean, they've been pretty bad at tech transfer.
They've been
right?
horrible at tech transfer
and,
traditionally.
And I know that Rice is still trying to see about getting this right with things like at the Ion, et cetera.
Yeah.
Right? So maybe tell me a little bit about what kind of jet fuel are you pouring on these students or faculty that are coming with a startup idea, say, "Hey, we've got this IP or something that was invented at the university.
Yeah.
I want to build a business around it." What do you do?
Yeah. So I think the first step of solving any problem is admitting you have a problem. Mm. And I think universities and the leadership there have been a lot more willing in the last 5 years to reexamine some of their priors and acknowledge that we were doing great at inventing. We weren't doing great at translating those inventions beyond. And some of that's about, the policies of universities and maybe preferring to license to more surefire bets like, big Fortune 100, Fortune 500 companies versus smaller, riskier startups. I think some of it was about the programs. You need dedicated programs because deep tech commercialization is a very different game than building software, than building a CPG product. So you need the programs. You need the policies, and then you need the personnel. You need people who know deep tech commercialization, and you need to build the capacity within your faculty and within your PhD and postdocs predominantly that are doing the research to know that entrepreneurship's a path, know what it means, and be inspired and energized to pursue that path. So I think there has been a lot of improvement over those years. I've seen Rice do a complete 180 from when I arrived, where we now have a new head of the Office of Tech Transfer, a new head of the Office of Research. But I think there was it started with an acknowledgement that we need terms to get these licenses out of the Office of Tech Transfer that are palatable not only to the entrepreneur, but to the investors.
Yeah.
And that was a broken piece of the puzzle. There's a big philosophical difference there, which is academia tends to value prior venture and value creation. It's all about what have you published? What grants have you won in order to unlock that brass ring of tenure for a lot of the researchers and faculty? Well, entrepreneurship's not about what have you done for me. It's about what are you gonna do for the business? And I think that shift in terms of what matters and the time horizon that you're looking at, that played a big part in kind of that reckoning that's going on across higher ed right now. You know, our job is to educate ourselves about what are the emerging models of new venture creation that are occurring in the real world and be that connective tissue that brings that into the university experience for a lot of these students. Because to your point, Chris, their attempt to do it for the first time, it's going to be messy, it's going to be ugly, mistakes are going to get made. Those mistakes become a lot more costly when they get done after they cross the graduation stage. You know, we give not a lot of money, 10 grand, right, to each of these innovation fellows, but what they're able to do with that in that amount of time, a 12-month program, is astounding. And you really see, it's the closest analogy I can give is like being a parent. Because you see your kids start taking their first steps. And then all of a sudden you look up and it's like, oh, this person's like making their 12th hire and selling to Fortune 100 companies. And like, my baby can walk. And this is incredible and amazing. And I think allows us to also, you know, earn the right longer term by our effort and our investment before others understand that. Hopefully we can play a long game, because the reality is the next generation of donors, transformational donors back to Rice, are going to be entrepreneurs, are people who make and create value and wealth and then want to give back to support the next generation.
That's so, the flywheel.
That's exactly what the flywheel is.
Which we're trying to also get going just in general in Houston.
Yeah, very much so.
Because you want them to grow and incubate and
definitely
succeed and then exit and then fund the next level of startups. And the same thing happens with donors. Anything stand out in the last 3 years? I mean, I know it's also very early, so sometimes we get the same question with our pre-seed, right? I mean, because it takes 10 years a lot.
Definitely.
Time, right? And so, but anything in the last 3 years that really—
Specific ventures
you want to highlight? Yeah, I mean, any particular startups that
Absolutely.
Have spun out that you want to maybe highlight?
Yeah, to be clear, we love all of our children
of course.
Equally.
Yeah,
okay,
of
we
course.
Love all of them equally. Yeah. There was an amazing company called Helix Earth Technologies, a phenomenal founder, Rawan Rashid, that came out of that first cohort of Rice Innovation Fellows, won our Napier Rice Launch Challenge New Venture Competition in 2022, got into Chain Reaction Innovations, kind of science to startup program based in, I believe, Tennessee. He is on the precipice of some major news announcements here, but last year had raised $1.3 million, has customers kind of lined up and ready to go, is now a tenant over at Greentown, right? So we've successfully helped catalyze that venture, helped them reach escape velocity, and transition to the right next place for them that hopefully keeps them here in Houston for the long term. There've equally been, a number, I'm just trying to do the math of who I can talk about.
Yeah.
Tierra Climate's another phenomenal one in the climate space, near and dear to our hearts, near and dear to, I think, my heart, yours, and everybody who lives in Houston these days. They have some incredible software that's all about solving the economics gap for battery builders so we can decarbonize the grid, have energy storage, but have the right incentives for all the players in that ecosystem. And they raised a great round of funding. Both co-founders are Rice alums, but the one that we got to work with that was in the Summer Venture Studio last year is Emma Kinnett, who's just she's a world breaker. She's incredible. And again, predominantly staying here in Houston. Which is, we love to see too.
Who is investing in these companies? You said that one raised 1.3 million. Where's that money coming from?
I think that's in general. A decent split between kind of local angel investors, some of the local VCs, and then traditional VCs from the coasts. I think the silver lining to COVID was it broke the paradigm that I think kept a lot of the venture investors captured by their geography and an unwillingness to get on a plane.
Yeah.
And I think now that they're seeing, particularly we're seeing Houston be a landing spot and be a destination for a lot of those VCs because they're seeing game-changing technology, because they're seeing companies that have a lot of their customers right here in our backyard in the Houston area, third largest, fourth largest city in the country, most diverse city in the country. This should be a stop on the map for folks who are hunting for great companies, great deals, maybe more reasonable valuations than what you might see in the Bay or Boston or elsewhere.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, yeah, it's a very interesting split. I think we're seeing more unique funds spinning up here local to Houston as well. There is a preponderance of venture in town for software companies. I think we're starting to see the earliest kind of green shoots of deep tech, hardware, hard tech, clean tech, climate, et cetera, also setting up shop here.
I was wondering how those venture firms learn about these companies.
Yeah.
You know, do you have demo days or how are they getting exposure?
Yeah, a couple of different times a year. So we have demo day for our summer accelerator, kind of happens in the first week of the academic year. Mm-hmm. So August 27th, Hudspeth Auditorium. More information at entrepreneurship.rice.edu for any of the listeners. And we use that as a way to be the Pulp Fiction shot of adrenaline to the heart of the campus community right at the start of the year. Show these other students, bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, full of energy. This is where you can be in 1 year's time if you just get started now. Mm. And so we always invite external folks from the community and investors to opportunities like that. But I would tell folks, just reach out to me. And our job is to be the concierge and get you connected to the right startups, the right deals, the right players across the Rice campus so that you don't have to think, you don't have to hunt and gather. Myself and my team are here to do that legwork for you.
All right, so you've worked with a lot of entrepreneurs and a lot of new entrepreneurs. Maybe if you have a few common mistakes that new entrepreneurs make and how to maybe avoid them.
Yeah, definitely. First and foremost, I think more startups die because of founder team issues than product or market issues. I think people get so excited in the early days of a startup that they naturally focus on maybe what their safe space is, which is selling to customers or building product. And they don't really invest the amount of time and energy that they really should, making sure that they've got a strong foundation, strong respect, and the early stirrings of a culture on that team, that you have the operating system for how are we going to get stuff done? Because the reality is the volume of decisions you have to make and the velocity with which you have to make those decisions increases exponentially as you grow and the deeper down the rabbit hole you get. And if you are kind of having to litigate those decisions in real time instead of having, you know, zones of competence or responsibility where people have decision-making autonomy, where you have a rubric for, you know, how do you make decisions if there's two founders and you disagree with one another? Does CEO win that fight or something else? In the heat of that moment, totally the wrong time to be figuring out those rules of how to get stuff done. So I think people tend to underinvest in the founder relationship and just kind of coast off of the honeymoon period until they start having to make really hard decisions that are more substantive than like, where are we going to get dinner tonight?
Well, the partner selection is definitely, it's basically the analogy is getting married.
Right? Yeah. And oh, so, very much so.
Because it is a long-term, multi-year
definitely
effort.
Yeah.
You know, we've all been on project teams where like, you know, hey, why are there nine people here and I'm doing all the work, right? You know?
Yep, we get some of those every now and then.
And then also, I mean, traditionally, venture tends to want to have co-founders.
Oh, yeah.
And that, on the other hand, though, when you have co-founders, then you have that potential friction, yeah, and how do you split the equity and all that, and technically it shouldn't really be split down the middle because,
yeah,
you need to have a decision maker,
yeah,
and you know it is a complicated issue that has nothing really to do with the actual idea and the startup itself, and
yeah,
it's all about the relationship, and
yeah,
can I work with you for the next 10 years to build this venture,
yeah, right?
And how well do I know you,
yeah,
and then also you add on all the challenges of a startup. That puts a lot of pressure on things.
Very much so.
And then you add on money,
yeah,
which makes people weird.
Yep.
You know, and so it's just
an ego.
An ego, yeah, and everything else. And so it actually is something that happens very early on before, like you said, and has enough time been invested in. Is this partnership really going to get,
yeah,
work?
Yeah. Right? You got to date before you get married, yeah, right? Sometimes you just need to be, yeah, equally stubborn as your partner to say, like, yeah, we might be, sure, fighting like cats and dogs, but like, I'm not going to walk away. You walk away. And then, great, like we're in a stalemate, but it's a good one,
it's
for all the
one,
right,
yeah,
reasons.
So selecting your partner and co-founder, yeah, definitely a big point. Was anything else that really stands,
yeah,
out to you?
Yeah, I think focus, particularly for first-time founders, mm-hmm, or founders who are early in their professional career. The ability that focusing on the things that matter, on the things that move the needle, can have for you as a founder and for your venture, I don't think there's anything like it. Like, that's my drug of choice, Chris.
Mm-hmm.
And I think as a founder, you have an unlimited to-do list across areas that you are comfortable with and areas that are deeply uncomfortable, very ambiguous for you. And I think you can end up, and I've certainly seen a lot of founders end up making the mistake of doing superficial work that looks like work, but doesn't move the needle anymore. You know, we came up with the name for our company. Like, mm-hmm, you're going to change that 50 more times until you ever get customers. Like, I can't even tell you how many hours I wasted. I'm sure you've done the same through your many ventures of like looking up Latin root words and all sorts of crazy things to like try
domain
and find the
names.
Yeah, domain names. It's just like, okay, like get checkout, a soft tech. Like, mm-hmm, that's what we are, and we'll figure out the exact spelling or the camel casing or whatever,
mm-hmm,
down the road. So I think focusing on what matters.
Which is easy to get distracted, like you said, because first of all, there's things you like to do.
Yep.
Second of all, there's things like, it's a form of procrastination.
It is.
Where you're like, hey, there's some really hard stuff I need to do, and then I have some easy stuff. And
yeah,
so I'll just do these easy things.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. It's candy. It's, you know, serotonin. You get, mm-hmm, the serotonin hit, but not the real kind of, I guess, like the full joy that you get after like a long bike ride or a full body workout or something where it's like, I put the work in, I can feel that new muscle being built, and it was painful and that hurt and was awkward, but I did it and I'm better and I'm further along. And
is that
so,
something that you coach on in,
very
the,
much,
in the lab?
Yeah, very much so. Mm-hmm. Just like, you know, how do you make sense of the world of to-dos,
mm-hmm,
and how do you have radical prioritization so that, you know, particularly if you're in the CEO role, but you're maybe coming from a technical background and still contributing to the product, you're gonna get pulled in a million different directions. Well, you gotta make time. So time management, just like prioritization, a lot of the soft skills, a lot of kind of the mental models that our founders need to work on, that's actually what they need the most help with a lot of the time, because that's what has been least developed by some of the more traditional parts of their educational experience, right? We can't make them a better engineer or a better scientist. That's not our job to be done, right? We're here to help be entrepreneurial alchemists and turn that into the potential for somebody to be a leader, a founder, you name it.
I imagine coming from a university environment where there's a list of things and a list of homework and things that have to be done, and all of it has to be done.
Yeah.
And you go into an entrepreneurship role where there's a lot of things on the list and a lot of them are not ever gonna get done.
Totally.
And you have to prioritize what's most important.
Because it's a totally
being comfortable different with the fact that,
yeah,
you're never gonna get to the number 50.
And by the way, speaking of being comfortable, I think the biggest thing in universities is teaching students, particularly if you're at a university like Rice, where we have a lot of high achieving, high ambition, high drive students. The biggest thing you gotta teach them is you drink failure by the carton as an entrepreneur, not by the glass. And you gotta learn to live with it and kind of reframing what failure is for them. There's an investor, Josh Wolf from Lux Capital, who I love his writing and the clarity with which he communicates very complex things. And he's essentially said something along the lines of, failure is only failure if you fail to learn from failure. Mm. There's a lot of F words in that. But I think it's really true. And a big part of our work is reframing, okay, you didn't get that customer. That pitch wasn't your best effort. You know, you didn't get accepted to this program or that program or the other. How to use that as an opportunity to learn and grow and come back better, stronger, faster the next time around versus shrinking like a violet from that failure. And also that if your startup fails, that's not a scarlet letter of failure that lives with you forever, the same way as XYZ experience in high school or in other parts of their undergrad might. This is the beauty of our startup world and our startup ecosystem is failing forward is very much a thing. And it's what did you learn from that failure and how did you grow from that failure, which is a very different message than they're maybe hearing from their family or from their friends or from their faculty, whatever it might be.
There's a definition some people use for entrepreneurship, and that's like an entrepreneur is someone who's willing to fail at something.
Yeah, absolutely.
To take that leap, learn something new, and fail at it.
Yeah.
That's entrepreneurship.
Yeah. I've talked, Rashid that I mentioned earlier, his and I, probably the phrase that we text back and forth most to each other is, just got to eat glass and make a meal out of it. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not going to be fun getting those learnings, but that's how you grow as a founder. Like if something works out and you get that deal or you close that term sheet or you make that hire or whatever it is, sometimes it's so much easier to learn from failure than from success. Mm-hmm. And
learn by doing.
Yeah. I mean, that's the nature of entrepreneurship. It's a contact sport. Like mm-hmm. that's why that informs very much our philosophy of how we teach our classes. And like, can entrepreneurship be taught? Absolutely. What's the right way to teach it? Well, that's up for debate, but we believe very firmly you learn it by doing it, by learning it and applying it in real time, not just staying in the theory of it.
Hmm. Interesting. Are there any upcoming events that you'd like to highlight? I know you threw one out there earlier, but you know that maybe some opportunities that at Lilie that maybe some aspiring entrepreneurs should look out for.
Yeah, absolutely. We love to start every new year with a fresh slate, and we started with a bang. And a couple of years ago, we started an event series, which takes up the whole first week of class, so August 26th, 27th, 28th, and 29th. And we throw a festival of everything innovation, entrepreneurship, science, tech, and art, and the intersection of those disciplines for the Rice campus and community. So that Monday, the 26th, we're going to have a phenomenal guest speaker do a fireside chat. We'll be announcing who that person is in probably a week or so. Tuesday, like I said, is the demo day for Lilie's Summer Venture Studio Accelerator Program. 8 incredible teams that are going to blow your mind and kind of bend the will of the world to show you how they're changing the game. I would love for the whole community to come on out to that. We've got space. We can accommodate for them. And then kind of we close the aperture a little bit. And then Wednesday and Thursday are a lot more for the campus ecosystem and community. But those first two events are open to the public. We'd love to have any of the listeners of the pod come on through and come into our world. If you're in Houston, if you're a founder, if you're looking for talent for your company, if you're looking for IP to start a company, or you're looking to give back and mentor that next generation, we would love to have you be a part of this constellation of mentor and community that we're pulling together at Lilie and really help Rice stay at the forefront of not just entrepreneurship, not just tech commercialization, but really what's going on in the world, because we have all the right ingredients to solve the grandest challenges of humanity over the next couple of decades, but we can't do it without you and without all of you out there as well.
And I assume investors as well, right?
Investors, absolutely. Corporate innovators. You know, we're here to support entrepreneurs and innovators of all stripes. We run a number of different programs for aspiring venture capitalists. And it wouldn't be right. We wouldn't be doing our job if we were saying, yeah, community, come on in, but no investors, no, thank you. Yeah, we would love to have any investors, angels and others come on by and just see the incredible stuff being worked on at Rice and these amazing founders who are ready to take the leap.
Well, I'm looking forward to it.
We're looking forward to having you. we'll give a shout out to you on the stage. You can hold me to that.
All right, there you go.
We're an open aperture and an open funnel for all that. You can reach out directly to me. My email address is, I don't know if I should be giving this out to the world, kyle.juda@rice.edu. Or you can go to our website, entrepreneurship.rice.edu, and we have a number of different forms there for folks who are interested in mentoring or interested in guest speaking in a course or any of the different programs that we have going on. Particularly mentorship is key. I don't know about you, Chris, but I have my life and my entrepreneurial trajectory changed by having the right mentor enter my life and enter my company at the right time. And we've seen what an enormously powerful lever that is. You don't have to be an entrepreneur to mentor other entrepreneurs. And so some of our most impactful mentors are folks who spend their days at Chevron or at Stripe or somewhere else in between. And again, are looking to be surrounded and kind of get some of that young energy transfer going on.
Because you need the marketing, you need the legal, you need the financial, you need go to market, you need so many things.
Definitely.
That, you know, anybody in any of those types of roles can mentor a founder who doesn't know anything about marketing.
Totally.
Per se.
Totally. And, you know, I've got little kids. We love Pixar movies. Ratatouille is one of my favorite. And the kind of call sign of that movie is like anyone can cook, right? We believe anybody can cook in an entrepreneurial sense as well. And again, whether that's the founder, whether that's as a mentor, an advisor, you name it, doors open, inboxes open. And we just want to grow what's going on at Rice and what's going on at Houston and contribute towards this incredible community that we have here in our backyard.
Well, thanks for coming on. I think we could talk for another couple of hours, but I learned a lot about Lilie, and I'm looking forward to coming out at the end of the month. That's fortuitous. I have a little something for you.
Oh, thank you.
Always give out stocks. I've got my Wave Kanagawa socks on today.
Nice.
I got some.
Excellent.
I don't know. You probably have 10 pairs of owl socks, but you know, maybe you don't have those.
I love them. and this orange, I left it in the car so that I'd look somewhat professional today. But I have a hat this exact same color in the car. So nice. You know me so well. And since Turnabout is fair play here, and you know, we can't have. Our friends of Lilie and friends of Rice Entrepreneurship wandering around town without representing. I too have a gift for you, Chris.
Nice.
Our fresh off the presses 2024 friends and family of Lilie. So you're a part of our constellation of awesomeness here now. And
nice.
And now
I
you can wear it everywhere you
All
go.
Right, I'll wear it proudly. I don't know if I'll pass for a college student or not, but you know, I'll try.
Faculty, PhD.
Faculty, yeah, there you go.
You know, a PhD that maybe stuck around too long, but we'd love to, grateful to have you guys and you in particular be a part of our world and a part of what's cooking here in Houston.
Well, thanks for coming on and sharing.
Of course. Likewise. Thanks for having me. Yeah.